Okay, it's the 1 o'clock rock. You've been waiting to see John Carroll, Republican, candidate for the United States Senate, the third time. And practice makes perfect with John Carroll. John Carroll and I knew each other as practicing lawyers way back when. Yeah. One time I took a Hawaiian Airlines plane, and my goodness, he was in the cockpit flying the plane. And then he was in the state house, was it, for a long time. 8 years he was in the state house. And then he started running for Senate.
No, then
the
I
Hawaii,
ran.
The Hawaii Senate, yeah.
Yeah, the Hawaii State Senate, yeah.
Yeah. And, what a fantastic career. And then you ran for governor a couple of times, and yeah. Now this is the third time you're running for the United States Senate,
exactly.
Trying to unseat Brian Schatz.
Yes. Yeah.
So, what drives you, John? You really want to have a public life, don't you?
Well, not really. I'm responding to a draft that had a friend of mine took me to give a speech on the Jones Act to the Visayan Community Council out there in Wahiawa. In Waipahu, and they had a draft John Carroll set up for signatures, and 20 minutes after the speech, they had four pages filled with these all Democrats saying, you got to run for U.S. Senate. And I think as soon as people understand the impact of the Jones Act, which I know most of the people don't even know, they will vote for whoever's going to make that happen. And I've been working on trying to get it passed since 1970. I'm not passed, but eliminated.
Yeah.
And
That's a really important part of your platform, isn't it?
It's the primary. Number one, it is for the state of Hawaii, this Jones Act is primary. And I have this, 12 great-grandkids coming up, and I'm looking at the future, and I figure if I die without doing what I am able to do, then I ought to be punished. So I figure I will do it, and I have had an aortic transplant, just for your information, and I feel like I'm about 30 years old, which is very deceptive because my looks don't show that. But I feel very comfortable doing it. I feel it's fulfilling something that I've been trying to do for a long time. It's my last chance, and every place I go, I seem to get a very nice reception in spite of my looks and all of this. So.
You know, you are certainly wedded to the Jones Act issue, and good for you because you're absolutely right about that. We've had a number of shows about the Jones Act. We talked to Mike Hansen, you must know him.
Oh, absolutely.
All the time, and Kali'i Akina, for that matter.
Yep.
And what strikes me, though, is that you're the only candidate that I know of that's actually taking a position to try to, accept Hawaii from the effects of the Jones Act. Is there anybody else?
I haven't heard that. Charles DeJoux and Ed Case both took crack at it with resolutions when they're in the U.S. House. And both times, I think Inouye and that whole gang came down on them. And I know Ed Case lost his seat to Hanabusa, and I think she got about $700,000 or $800,000 from A&B and Matson for that race. And I'm not sure what happened with Charles, but I know he was in there for a short time and then gone. So neither one of them were able to do this. McCain has tried it, and he hasn't done it, but I think nobody's really made this the case before the U.S. Senate. And the fact of it is, it's an absolute deliberate interference with interstate commerce. Could I just tell your audience what...
Sure, please, take a moment.
Okay. Well, the Jones Act essentially is a federal law that says that if a ship is not built, manned, maintained, owned, and flagged and in America, or by Americans, it cannot travel in interstate commerce. So the net effect is if a ship wants to come in with fertilizer from Korea or someplace like that and drop off a half of a load of fertilizer or whatever it may be, automobiles, they can come here with no problem, but they cannot go to another state. They've got to go to Mexico or Canada and then to another state. And this law affects Hawaii more than any other state. It affects Alaska to some extent. It's affected the East Coast and the South Coast of the United States when they wanted to bring in foreign ships to do certain things after hurricanes. But for Hawaii, it's absolutely ridiculous. And I prepared, I should say, a fellow named Al Frenzel, who was a professor at the Army War College, and he prepared this, but this will show you the difference in the price amounts that we have to pay to live here. And the most shocking thing, if I can share this, because I'm a retired veteran, I'm able to shop in the PX and the commissary.
Oh, I didn't mention that. No. You're a United States Air Force and U.S. Army Korean War veteran, too.
Yeah, yes. Anyway.
Amazing for a man of 30 years of age.
That's what I say. Very few people have had 86 years to prepare for a new job, you know. So anyway, but I went to the PX and to buy a half a gallon of milk. And we usually I get in the commissary. I got there, it was almost five, I think it was $4.95 for a half a gallon of milk. I was in Oregon about, 3 weeks ago, and I was just doing comparisons. And a gallon of milk in Oregon, it was about $2.95. A half a gallon of milk was $1.89. So $1.89, and that's $5 in the PX. I don't know what it costs at Safeway, but it's got to be somewhere around that amount. And for us to have to pay that for milk that's not even fresh milk is absolutely absurd. What's even more absurd is I'm driving in from Pearl City to go to work, and we've got this huge billion-dollar project going on, and there's potholes and practically trenches and metal plates all the way across. So you've got this almost like third-world street next to this billion-dollar project. Now, that is what I call an absurdity. And that's the kind of thing that I would intend to change as your U.S. senator.
Okay. Well, okay, that's, I'm glad we, what other platforms, what other points on your platform?
Okay, well, number one, in the as far as the U.S. side of it, that is the national, we are, you know, I was an operations officer, office planner when I was in the military, and I went to Air War College and Air Command and Staff College, and we did study and discuss at length unconventional warfare. Well, the number one tenet in an unconventional war is that you determine who is the enemy. We have no idea who the enemy is in this particular war. We're having skirmishes. I was looking at statistics from 2002 until July of this year. We had 14 terrorist attacks between January and July of this year, 14. And in it, if you're looking at an ops planner, the enemy has lost one or two of its soldiers, and we've lost anywhere from three or four to like 25 or 30 or 50 or whatever it may be. So in terms of losing or winning the war, operationally, we're totally losing. We don't know where they are, who they are, or why they are. These are things that have to be done. The only way that we're ever going to find out is we've got to get a cadre of people, and I hate to call them spies, but basically people that can infiltrate the mosques and the different areas where these people can be found and then infiltrated and then go on from there with intelligence to really go after them and then go after whatever logistical support. We've got to understand their command and control and whatever that may be. But when you're looking at all the statistics and they're in Africa and in every country you can think of, these terrorist attacks are going on. Now, whether they're all tied together, I don't know. But that's something we need to know if we're going to fight a war. And I think I bring this background to the Senate. Mm.
So what would you do in terms of developing that intelligence? You embed people? Obviously it can't all be remote control.
Oh, no,
you have
absolutely.
To get in on the ground. You have to train people to speak the language and be able to embed themselves.
What I am looking at is to get with everyone, particularly the people in the Middle East, the Jordanians, possibly Egyptian, obviously the Israelis, people that can infiltrate, unbeknownst to the people around them, and who have been trained to go in and get this kind of intelligence for us. It's going to take some efforts. Number one, on our boots on the ground, forget it. I believe if there's something we want to be destroyed or whatever, we can do it with air power. We do not need any boots on the ground.
Well, we have to have the intelligence.
We have to have, that's the one, yes, excuse me, for that. But I'm saying that the bulk of this cadre should be coming out of the Middle East, not out of San Francisco or someplace.
Because it's really high-stakes poker for
exactly.
them.
Exactly, and to be able to fit into the community, they've got to appear to be part of the community, and that's the only way it's going to happen. Yeah. But
what about diplomatic relations? Do you have a position on that, a platform plank on the question of what sort of diplomatic relations we should have at this point, especially with Europe, but also with Asia?
Well, I think they're critical, and that's, can I share? When I ran for U.S. Congress in 66, Nixon had lost the presidential against Kennedy. He lost the California governorship, and I had to spend about 2 hours with him in front of the airport, and during that time, I had just coming from command and staff, I was a total hawk on the Vietnam War. He said, John, we have no business in Vietnam. When French asked us to help them with Dien Bien Phu, we denied it. We gave them logistical support, but that's it. And then he went on to talk about about international peace. And what he said was, is that with international peace, it's going to come through international trade and commerce. That's the only way it's going to happen. So I'm looking at very much open free trade. And in fact, what happened was I thought when the people said Trump was going to run, I thought, what is this jackass doing, even thinking about running? But then I heard him all through the debates, and the more I heard, the more I realized the guy thinks exactly like Nixon, and he's got this tremendous background in international commerce. And I'm thinking this guy could be the greatest president we ever had. Now, I know my staff doesn't want me to even mention Trump around here, but that is my actual...
We need to know how you feel.
Well, that's how I feel. Yeah. I'll tell you how I really feel later. But,
okay.
But anyway, so that's one thing. And the U.S. economy is really critical to me, and I see the solution is going to come through a very conservative Congress. It's going to take... we've got to look at regulations. I think that places like the Department of Education, some of these intrusive federal government involvements have got to go, and I'm going to be on the stump on that.
Mm-hmm.
And
you mentioned in passing the economy, and I'd like to know your platform on that. I mean, we have some stats that are good, some that are not so good. A lot of people dissatisfied, and they just happen to be supporting Trump in large part, I think. But they're not happy with the economy. What would you do to fix the economy in Congress, in the Senate?
Well, what Trump is talking about doing is exactly what I would be doing, because we've got way too much regulation, way too much taxation, and there's really not that many, other than the Jones Act, there's not too many impairing type laws as far as international trade is concerned. But we have to, your question originally was about our allies, and that's where I was actually getting to, is that we need to work with everybody, whether it's they're not our allies, but with everybody that's out there, and let them see what the benefit is of trading with us, being partners with us, and then going on from there. Like RIMPAC here, we've got the Chinese communists coming in here in their ships, and we're buddies with them. So I would totally favor that sort of thing. But it's
would
there
favor
to,
having them join us in RIMPAC.
Yeah.
What about other aspects of diplomatic relations? For example, there's an issue about the South China Sea, and we have some consternation over the decision in The Hague, the tribunal in The Hague a few weeks ago. What position would you take on that?
Well, the South China Sea thing, I mean, Taiwan should be the ones screaming about that at the UN, and we can go in there and back them up there. As far as bombing it or taking it out, I'm... And don't ask me that question. But I'm sorry, but I have a fairly hawk-like streak in me. And if I think something's hurting our country, then I'm ready to obliterate it. So, but
what position would you take on North Korea then?
Okay. The position I take, if Pyongyang did what if I were president right now, they would not have a nuclear capability. I can tell you that. And I'd say the same for Iran. I'd say the same for Pakistan. So, yes.
Now, you know, in Congress, we have people consider it dysfunctional for a lot of reasons, but they can't seem to make up their minds on funding, you know, the government, and they argue about things, and they do these kind of hostage... they hold issues hostage, and then the result is we don't have any action. So arguably, you know, Congress is dysfunctional right now. What would you do to fix that?
Well, the only thing that I can do that I know of would be to just express myself vocally and try to get as much information, however I could, out to the rest of the people in the Senate and into the House. And you probably don't know this, but when I was in the State House here, we were in the process of starting to think about environmental protection legislation. And I introduced a bill that forced the sugar planters to have to silt all of that water before it went into the ocean, because as a fighter pilot, I'm coming in from 250 miles north, and there's acres of bagasse out there. So
when you say silt, you mean remove the silt?
Well, remove the bagasse from, so that the, yeah. Yeah, the, in other words, all the silt stays on shore and then the water goes back in the water. It's because it used to be there'd be 2 or 3 miles, it would look like coffee in front of every meal, you know,
Hakalau.
Yeah, and so anyway, when as soon as I got in, I did that, and then of course I never got another penny out of Castle and Cook or the. But what I did do is I got every single environmental law that we now have passed by working with Gene King and Tadao Beppu and Richard Kawakami and John Ushijima and the guys on both sides. And I think I can do the same thing because I'm just able to see where they're coming from and I'm able to convince them of what makes sense and let them, the only bill that I got credit for was the green sea turtle and monk seal protection, which is not being properly enforced, by the way. But anyway.
Okay, we're going to take a break now, John.
Sorry.
When we come back, I'd like to ask you about the monument, how you feel about the monument out there, because everybody's talking about it lately.
Yes.
Community Matters with John Carroll. He's a third-time candidate for the United States Senate, and he's Republican, and we're talking about his platform, and we'll be right back.
Aloha, everybody. My name is Mark Shklov. I'd like you to join me for my program, Law Across the Sea, on ThinkTech Hawaii. Aloha.
Aloha, I'm Kirsten Baumgart-Turner, host of Sustainable Hawaii. Thanks for watching ThinkTech this summer. We have a lot of terrific shows of great importance, and I hope you'll watch my show too every Tuesday at noon as we address sustainability issues for Hawaii. They're really pertinent as the World Conservation Congress approaches in September and the World Youth Congress that's focusing on sustainability next year as well. Have a great summer and tune in at noon every Tuesday.
Welcome to ThinkTechHawaii.com. This is Johnson Choi, your host. My focus is Asia in Review. We talk about interesting subjects in Asia. Be sure to check the ThinkTech.com website on the next topic. Thank you.
We're back. We're here with John Carroll, Republican and third-time candidate for the United States Senate. Running against Brian Schatz, among others. There's a lot of people in the field, actually. So you had something during the break about some jumper cables, and I think we need a little humor, so tell us the story.
Well, okay, the jumper table goes into the bar. The bartender says, I'll serve you, but don't start anything.
Ooh. You know, I heard that within the last 24 hours
she's
of going
laughing,
around.
She's not laughing, so she'd never work with jumper cables. I can see that.
We'll have to explain all this to our young staff.
Yes.
So, John, we're looking for positions, you know, and I was going to ask
monument,
you.
Monument, yeah.
Monument, yeah.
Right. Okay, well, first of all, our Coast Guard is not doing what they're supposed to be doing. The monument, as it's currently, you know, geographically put in place, and by the way, because of all of that environmental legislation that I put in, the federal fish and wildlife people took me out to Curay and Pearl and Hermes and Midway to see what kind of conditions were out there. So I'm not just talking out of my hat here. But as far as I understand it, there's a 200-mile border that needs to be sacrosanct. But our Coast Guard is allowing other, you know, ships from Japan and Korea and I don't know where the heck else, but they're coming in, taking the fish and going out of there. So number one, I believe that they've got to enforce the rules out there, and if it takes more money for the Coast Guard, then so be it. As far as expanding it, I'm against it because there's so much of our fisheries is dependent upon that, and they're already excluded, and our people are obeying the law, but these other foreign ships are going in. So I think that to expand it doesn't make any sense to me at all, and I would fight to the death.
Of course, as it is.
Yes. Yeah.
One other issue that's a sort of a federal issue these days, and it strikes me that it's important for us to know how you feel about it, is especially in light of all these domestic attacks, is gun control. After the last one of them, so many of them, you say they're all over the calendar, and it's not only jihadists; it's ordinary, you know, domestic terrorism. Our own people who don't even pretend to be jihadists are using guns and killing police, for example.
Yeah.
So what's your position on gun control? Would that be useful in reducing risk to American citizens?
I think it would be creating more risk for American citizens. Number one, I might as well tell you, I'm a lifetime member of Hawaii Rifle Association. But the whole purpose of the Second Amendment is to allow people to protect themselves in their homes, and to have anything that's going to erode the right to own an arm, in my book, I'm ready to shoot whoever wants to do that. So, I mean, that's, okay. I'm just being funny, but that's it really how I feel it. There, it's a sacrosanct. It's not just a hunting permit thing. It's a life protection, and I believe firmly that we should maintain that at all costs.
Going to issues that are federal but that have a big effect here is TMT, you know, the 30-meter telescope. Yeah. We've had a lot of protests about that, and right now it seems to be pretty much locked up.
Yeah.
What's your thought about that? Do you have a position? Can you help as a member of the United States Senate?
Okay. I believe I can help. The reason I say that is I'm in a halal, which is totally against the TMT. I dance hula, by the way. So. And they've got a big
sign. I'm not going to ask you to do that today.
Well, that's just a very good idea.
Well, it might be very persuasive. No. Why don't you just assume that John can dance the hula? Okay, go ahead.
But anyway, but as far as I'm concerned, the scientific advances that can be made, the discoveries that can be made, the enhancement of the Hawaiian culture can be increased if we can have that telescope. And I think that and my kids, grandkids, great-grandkids, all part Hawaiian, so it's not like I'm absent from the culture, but it's, I think to do anything to stop that would be really, really dumb, and I think that anything we can do to get it over with or get it into place operating makes a lot of good sense, and I will do what I can for that.
Another big local issue which has federal implications, of course, is rail, you know, because we are hoping to get some money from Washington that will, you know, ameliorate the cost, and the cost is bigger every time you look. And without federal money from Washington, it's going to be hard for us. So can Congress, you know, when Dan Inouye was occupying this very seat, you know, he was able to raise money from all directions in Congress, and he could fund projects like this and so many others. Could you do that for rail? Would you do that for rail? Where can you go in terms of developing the muscle it takes to raise money for Hawaii in the federal government?
Well, first of all, I'm working with a group called Do Rail Right, Al Frenzel, John Bond, Dr. Dudley, you know, Keone Dudley. Those folks have done a huge amount of research, and they've gone into the absolutely close to criminal activity that's taken place over these years. I am looking at that now, and I will reserve What I would do in Congress is basically to make sure that what we can do here is the proper thing to do, the economic thing to do, and the right thing to do. And at this point, I don't really know. As far as my own personal feeling about it is, they ought to stop it at the stadium, keep out of the floodplain altogether, which is where they're going to go when they come down the hill and by Halawa, and then run the buses out from there. Because right now, even if they run to Ala Moana, if you're working on Bishop Street or someplace like that, you know, where's the station where you're going to walk from there? It's not like Tokyo or someplace like that where you've got streetcars and things like that that are going by to help where after you get off of the train. And so I really think the whole idea was absurd to begin with. I believe that if we wanted one, we should have had an at-grade that ran from downtown. The old Oahu Rail would have saved a number of things. But we're also looking at what happened and who did what along the way. I do not have enough concrete information at this time to make a definitive statement. So.
Okay.
But I think it's in place. We've got to utilize what we have. I'm certainly not in favor of tearing it down or anything like that. It's actually a beautiful structure when you look at it. It makes you feel good, but it's just so absurd. In this, we're serving 200,000 people. They had 3 million out there, I'd say absolutely, but it's ridiculous.
The whole country is, you know, at a tipping point, I would say, in energy, in renewable energy. And so, for example, Hawaii is in a tipping point. We have just lost the possibility of a $4.3 billion deal with NextEra. And I wonder what your thoughts are about the status of our efforts in Hawaii to meet our goal of 100% renewable by 2045, and whether the federal government can help, should help, in terms of national energy policy that would have an impact on Hawaii's effort?
Well, number one, we should be already almost totally independent on alternative fuel. When I was in the legislature, we put in the first solar bill, the first wind bill, the geothermal, ocean thermal energy conversion, all of those came off of my desk. So number one is I'm totally looking at that and I'm totally committed to getting that done. I don't think we need money from the federal government to do it. I'm really happy, frankly, that the NextEra thing went down the chute. Those guys, I mean, what's happened here, and HECO is involved with it to some extent already, they will not give out the permits to allow the solar people to put in new solar panels in the different districts, and they've got this particular law that they passed in 2008 that allows them, when they put in, say, 10,000 new solar projects or, you know, solar generators in the neighborhood, whatever that does to their bottom line, they can then redistribute that through the rest of the ratepayers in the state to keep their bottom line where it was before that new 10,000 went in. So they've been reluctant to move forward with it. You've got people like Jeff Davis, the solar guy, and other people that have been a little bit, vocal on the issue. But as far as I'm concerned, that is the way to go. And Hawaii is so ideal. We can be basically an icon for the world on this subject matter. And so everything that I can do there to make that happen, I will do. But the idea of having one big corporation having any kind of control over alternative energy is not only acceptable, not acceptable, but it's just sickening to me to think of it. So,
John, you're running for essentially Dan Inouye's seat and now Brian Schatz's seat. Brian has been there for a couple of years developing, to the extent he can, an arrangement, influence in the Senate. Hopefully in the years to come, he might achieve some part of what Dan Inouye achieved over his lifetime in the Senate. And I wonder your thoughts about how you can match that. I mean, do you have a chance of winning, do you think? And do you have a chance of developing the kind of clout that Dan Inouye had and that Brian Schatz is developing right now as we speak?
Well, first of all, I don't think Brian is developing much clout among the Republicans from what I hear. And his major claim to fame right now is getting a poison to save the Lehua tree, which I applaud, by the way. My Hawaiian name is Kalelehua Okalani, so I have this affinity for that. But he took a very large donation from NextEra, which shows me that he has very little understanding of what we're trying to do here in terms of alternative energy. I can say this, I mentioned this aortic heart valve. I think I have the personality to get done among conservative Republicans the things that I think will make our state the best place in the world. Could I just divert slightly?
Take 30 seconds and finish.
Okay, Singapore has 250 square miles. They have a gross domestic product of about $120 billion a year. We have over 6,000 square miles, and we have a gross domestic product of less than $70 billion a year. We've got homeless people all over the place, jobless people all over the place. Singapore has none of that. They've got housing for everybody. I just had my landlady just got back from Singapore. She confirmed that. I see as Hawaii can be better than Singapore, better than Hong Kong, and it already is the best place in the world, and we can make it the most solvent place in the world. That's why I'm running.
Thank you. John Carroll, Republican candidate for United States Senate. Thanks for coming down to ThinkTech. Thanks for telling us your
thank you, Jay. It's a pleasure.
A pleasure. Aloha.
Aloha.